So very good afternoon, everybody. Hello and welcome to the Exchange for Media eConclave 2020. E4M eConclave aims to bring the most enthusiastic minds together from different segments of the industry. Once again, a very warm welcome to all of you. My name is Khyati Kawa and I'm going to be your e-host for this E4M eConclave. Today, when COVID-19 has taken over most of our decision-making power, but still, practitioners don't stop to evolve or innovate. During these sessions, experts won't only share how they are managing their operations, but also share their thoughts on the revival and how they have streamlined the functionalities in the past 1 month. Also, we are available and live on E4M portal, Facebook, Twitter, at E4M Tweets, Instagram, and YouTube, along with Zoom. Our official hashtag for this eConclave is the E4M webinar, hashtag E4M webinar. So please do follow us and stay connected for latest updates. Now, quickly moving on to our very first session for the eConclave. The pandemic has created uncertainty amongst all of us, whether individuals, organizations, or brands. So our first session is going to talk about, or rather try to answer, has this pandemic made brands more agile and created a new playbook for marketeers? And in conversation, we have with us Mr. Rahul Agarwal, Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer of Lenovo India. Rahul has over 24 years of professional experience and has held multiple leadership positions across Lenovo and IBM. Prior to his current role, he headed the commercial segment for Lenovo India, the largest business for Lenovo India. Before that, he headed marketing communications for Lenovo globally and is credited with setting up Lenovo Worldwide Marketing Hub in Bangalore, supporting 60 plus countries. Rahul will be in conversation with Dr. Anurag Patra, Chairman and Editor-in-Chief, BW Business World and Exchange for Media Group, who is an enthusiastic entrepreneur and an industry expert. Over to you, Dr. Patra.
Thank you, Khyati, for that kind introduction. Welcome, Mr. Rahul Agarwal, to this Exchange for Media webinar, Exchange for Media Conclave in a virtual format. As we discussed just before the webinar, we all are doing the best we can in the current circumstances. So how are you doing, Mr. Rahul Agarwal? Rahul, how are you dealing with this unprecedented pandemic, both on a personal level and a professional level?
I think we are all dealing with it every day as it comes. But a few things that I've been telling people around me and my office colleagues, number one is to keep your mind calm. Because this is a time when, a lot of uncertain information is being floated, which tends to stir the mind in the wrong way. So I'm telling people and myself that stay away from a lot of these unconfirmed information. Number two is not to overanalyze the impact of what this might have in the future. Because logically speaking, when you don't know what this is really all about, what is the intensity, what is the longevity, what is the reason, what is the cure, then I think it's a little too premature to say that the world will change in a way that we won't be able to identify. And a lot of people are kind of panicking, imagining things. And I tell people that human beings have this amazing tendency to come back to their routine once things tend to roll back to normalcy. So in a few ways, things will change, like work from home, less travel, more of these meetings. You know, people here who travel a lot know how painful it is. If I have to come to Mumbai, it's a 6-hour painful process from my house to the door that I want to reach. But in many ways, I think things may not change. The other internally, what we're doing is a lot of communication. Every day I'm doing at least one meeting with the external stakeholder and at least one roundtable with my employees and almost a daily meeting with the leadership team. And a lot of employee engagement is happening today. And of course, as any business would do, Anurag, we're doing a lot of plan A, plan B, plan C, and cutting down expenses. So it's a lot of future planning. So fundamentally, is the way I'm spending my time that has changed a lot. It is not to review the current business, but to review our preparedness for different outcomes of the future.
Thank you, Rahul, for laying out how you're dealing with so beautifully and in a very authentic way, real way. Rahul, I was in a conversation like this for Business World with Devarti Singh. She's now the senior VP at 3M in the headquarters in Minnesota, and she was earlier India MD and CEO for 3M, a fellow Bangalorean like you. Hmm. And someone in the audience asked her a question, and I want to give you the question. Everybody is referring to this pandemic as a black swan event. And he said, it's a gray rhino event. So gray rhinos appear from time to time. They appear more often than a black swan. So if this is a gray rhino event, and some experts believe that corona may resurface in the winter, and it may be there for the next 18, 20 months, in some form till the vaccine is discovered and the fear of corona can go away. So tell us your ABC plan. I'm not asking for very specific, but if this is true and you yourself said ABC, tell us some scenarios.
So, I don't want to talk about the disease, because the world has a lot of experts. There are 1,500 medical papers which are coming out every week by the experts. 1,500 every week, and that's going up. And every organization, whether it's McKinsey, BCG, Deloitte, EY, they are rolling out their analysis of what's going to happen. So I think in that context, Anurag, my view is quite unimportant. And I would not take my own view seriously, right? So I'm trying to take one step at a time. Don't analyze too much. Keep your mind calm. Do the right things. By doing the right things, I mean cut the expense, control the expense, and be nice to human beings. So, for example, we're going out of our way to make sure that we don't have to let people go. Out of our way. I'm saying, hey, cut everything else, but let's not go there. Three, we are trying to do things, from a CSR point of view, donations. We are helping some hospitals procure equipment and, so on and so forth, which I think a lot of good companies are doing. But as in my role, my professional role, I think all that I need to do is look at, hey, if the category that we deal in, it has three scenarios, because computer is a very interesting category. Many people think that it'll grow. I'm not sure. In the short term, I'm not sure. So the thing that we're dealing with is, if the market goes down by 20% is scenario, let's say, so A is market remains flat, that's scenario A. B is if market goes down by 20%. C is if we are pleasantly surprised, the market goes up by 5 or 10%, which is less likely. Then how do we run our P&L? How do we run our entire business processes? How do we manage our people? What expenses to cut? What to do about marketing? What messages to give to our customers? What messages to give to our employees, to our stakeholders? So I think it's a lot of that, which every week things change, because people's opinion about the future changes very fast, because there is nobody who can prove you wrong today about what you are saying about tomorrow.
Sure. So, you've been again, very real, saying that you're not sure whether the computer market will grow. And you're factoring all scenarios, and you're still optimistic, and you're focusing on the human side of things and doing the best you can in these circumstances. Well, while we talk of business, we want to talk to you about a little bit about marketing. You were now you're in a leadership, general management, MD, CEO role. But you're also the brand owner in some way, right? Being a global CMO, setting up the app. Tell us, as a brand owner, what are the brand activities you continue to do, and what are the brand activities you've put a stop to?
So, see, a lot of people ask me, hey, how is the brand changing? And I tell them a very simple answer, that brand cannot change, because my definition of a brand is if it has to have a character, and character means that it has to have some values. And the test of values is that when times are tough, can you still vouch by the same values? So as far as I'm concerned, I think the value of Lenovo brand is not changing. And what we are saying, however, to people might undergo a little bit of evolution. So for example, I know very well that a lot of parents are keen to get the second PC at home now. If they have two children, e-education, they want to make sure that they have two PCs. Many people who did not have PCs earlier, they're saying, okay, at least let me have one. I can't just depend on my office laptop for the weekend. So our messaging that is going to go out is, hey, how can we give you a full bundle? You know, how, which PC is the best for your family and what are the accessories that you need? Number two, in India, there's always an affordability issue. So the affordability issue is that, hey, I don't have the money upfront, especially now when salaries are getting cut, people are losing jobs. But in India, education gets top priority. So we are coming out with 2-year EMIs, right, so that people can pay, which is a big deal in a...
So what I'm hearing, you're observing the changing consumer behavior,
right,
and you're responding to it, not only in terms of the product offering, but in terms of pricing, in terms of financing, in terms of making sure that you really become a true partner in the consumer's journey.
True. So we also, for example, in RAL, we did something very novel. We said till the time this goes on, our service centers, which are fully operational, unlike many other companies, my AC has a problem, but my AC manufacturer for 2 months is off, but we are on. We are saying that we will support any brand free of cost.
Fantastic.
That is the kind of thing we're doing. We've also launched a campaign called Smarter Ed, which is a portal we've made, wherein people who want to teach can register. Students who want to learn can register.
Smarter Ed.
So you can just do a Google maybe.
Smarter Ed.
So it's a platform we've created. We've just launched it last week. With thousands of people like you and me have registered, think that, hey, now I have some time and I want to teach something. Students all over the country are registering. They're saying that, hey, I may have teachers, but the teachers are not really good, which is a big problem. There's a 1 million shortage of teachers. So we are doing these kind of things, which I would say that was always in our agenda. And therefore, I would say it's not new to the brand. But I think the situation demands that part comes out a little more than the commercial part.
Right. Fantastic. I think, you know, that's where innovation comes in. That's where a larger purpose comes. We support any brand, any make. And, you know, going back to your purpose of enabling people to what they want to do using a technology brand. So I after the webinar, I'll check smarterhead.com. And if we are somewhere towards the end to show the homepage, Priyanka, we must. Rahul, let me ask you a direct question, because we are talking to a group of CMOs who are logged in, or brand managers, or marketing professionals, advertising professionals, media professionals. Will the marketing budgets come down in the immediate near term? Tell us what will happen to marketing budgets in the short term, medium term, long term.
Well, for most categories, they will, unfortunately.
And by what percentage?
I think that will vary. So FMCG, I'm told, I have a lot of friends who are in that part of the FMCG, which is selling sanitizers. One organization which sells sanitizers, you know what is the explosion in the sanitizer business? 500x of the normal. So clearly they're going to advertise, right? FMCG actually may go up because people are going to be more cooking at home and, you know, spending more time at home. But most categories, I think the drop could be anywhere from 10% to 50%.
Thank you, Rahul, for being so specific. So, Rahul, if the drop is 50%, let's take the worst case scenario, and 50% is left, how will your marketing mix change? How will your media mix change? What are the thoughts in your head that you can share that can help the professionals who are watching you?
So I think some of the headlights are quite leading. It will definitely be a move to more digital, more performance-based marketing. Also, I would say more marketing which is not related to immediate business. So I think there is a bit of a dichotomy here, and I am seeing it in Lenovo. For example, we are cutting down on normal TV and print, right? We're doing a lot more digital, just starting to do digital, right? More performance-based measurable marketing. On the other hand, we are also open to spending more money on giving the larger message, because the brands don't mean much to an average consumer. Brands mean a lot to the brand managers. Unless you're talking about iconic brands which have been there for decades and maybe centuries. Otherwise, if you go do a survey, brands' perception will never match with what the brand manager or the CEO thinks, right? So this is also an opportunity to come out with what we truly believe in. Like smarter, right? We're spending money, right? So I think there are two kind of pathways that I see flowing, at least for Lenovo. But the traditional marketing budget will definitely go down. Digital will up. TV and print definitely, I think, should be very worried. I'm sorry, because right now people are not even getting the newspaper in.
No, we are. I read all my newspaper today. You can see them on the screen.
I get it too. So I'm not overreacting, just like you. But I think human behavior is very panic prone.
So Rahul, thank you. Know what I love about the conversation is you're very real. You're being very specific. You're not giving cliched answers. You're telling us as it is. And I think that's the mark of a great leader. Yes, you got to stay human centric. You got to be compassionate, but you also got to say what you got to say and do what you got to do. So I see that, so I must compliment you, because sometimes conversations are very goody-goody and they aren't real. Okay. So I must compliment you on for being so specific in giving us specific inputs. Now, let me make it a little philosophical, and I sent you those questions on leadership. When the lockdown started in the last week of March, I was confused. I was lost. I had feelings of guilt. Wish I had much more money, right? So that I could take care of my employees, I was worried about the future. But I gathered myself in the first 1 week, and I can say in the last 40 days, I have given it my best. I worked longer, harder. I have clarity on the future. Tell us what went through Rahul Agarwal's mind. You lead a very large organization, a very big brand. So as a leader, as an individual, how did you prepare yourself to be able to lead in this VUCA world?
So I think a lot is to do with the tenure. I'm almost finishing 5 years in this role. I think if I were in my first or second year, I would have panicked a lot. But what I experienced was that I just told myself that I got to accept this, because there is nothing that I can do. Number two is I realized everyone in the company is looking at me, my tone, my body language, what I say about the situation. And I don't believe in being artificial, right? I like to call a spade a spade, but I still felt positive that people might overplay the impact. And therefore, I started communicating a lot. I started talking a lot, and I told people that possibility is endless, but you got to look at the probability. And therefore, keep looking at the facts. Keep looking at what is within your sphere of control. And really not too much. As I said, I didn't overanalyze. We just did the right things. We didn't get into a panic mode of cutting things, but we said sensible cutting down of expenses, create scenarios, create situation. Because human mind, the human mind sees the worst of it when it goes through uncertainty. Now, if you can make your business heads look at scenario C, which is the worst, I think it calms you down subliminally. because then you know that, okay, things can't go worse than this, and you know, I'm prepared to an extent that I can be. So there's no playbook. I don't think I have done it very handsomely. I'm listening a lot to people. We have created more than 100 ideas in Lenovo, 100 ideas that I'm tracking personally. I think that is new. People are feeling very energized by ability to contribute to ideas, and we are implementing some of them. I think these are some of the things that you do. We're doing employee activities, and you know, and then I tell everyone, guys, if you're working in a company like Lenovo, firstly, you are privileged. Number two, you're not kids. Therefore, you got to find your own way to motivate yourself.
Good. So, you know, we're getting very interesting questions. And I'll start with the question. You know, the whole idea there is, Shalini Shankar asking, in the current scenario of reduced demand and customer being selected in the purchases, should brands opt for reaching consumers through campaigns and be on top of their mind, or should brands look at pricing and become more attractive? So is pricing going to play a bigger role? That's one question from Shalini Shankar. And the other question is from Amit Setia. I would like to hear your thoughts on future-proofing for the brand, future-proofing of the business from supply chain and consumption perspectives. He also had an add-on question, in what all aspects the brand will go for normalization, both in the short term and long term?
Yeah, a lot there. So, firstly, I don't think I'll have answers for everything. On the first one, straightforward, we are reaching out to, for example, the student community through schools now, which we never did earlier. We're going to be doing specific campaigns to reach out to students and give them messages as to what is the right thing to buy for them to have continuity in education. Pricing, I don't see pricing as a big lever in the current situation. And I think a brand which has a character and values will not try to take advantage of the situation if there's an opportunity. And we've seen good brands actually make statements on that. But if the demand goes down, will there be pressure on pricing? I think you have to study your industry and see what is the price elasticity. I don't think on computers, if I reduce the price by 5%, more people are going to buy. But if I can, if we can give them financing offers, then many people may come, provided they have the need. Second one was about the future proofing. I don't really am a big fan of future proofing. You can't do future proofing to even slightly.
And Amit is the CMO of Amit Setia is the CMO of a brand too. So
yeah. So see, I always talk about the price of perfection, right? The price of perfection is too high. And therefore, if you want to be prepared for a black swan event like this, the amount of investment you'll have to make may be too high. It may not be worth it. So I think if it's a regular event and people think that it can happen again, then yes, you should be prepared. And you know, I think every business will have its own playbook on what to do. One thing is just to be sensible. A lot of messages for startups who had unlimited money coming in. And I'm one of the few people who are vocal about it, that every business in the medium term needs to be sensible. So I think it's a good reminder that your business model needs to be a stable,
sustainable
one, right? You can't just keep sustaining on infinite money being infused, because it's a game of investors trying to outdo each other, which is what happens. So part of it is hygiene. And the other part, I think every organization will have to find its own answers. I can't generalize. I can just give some general principles, which I think for this esteemed group may not be of any value.
Okay, Raut, I want to ask you, will brands collaborate more? So for example, you talk to education segment, and hence I'm asking this question.
Yeah.
You could take it for other segments. Will, say, Lenovo partner with an edutech brand? Will it partner with an education website? Will it, you know, so will brands collaborate more than they ever did?
So a very good question. I would say brands should collaborate. Whether they will or not is to be seen. It's very difficult to collaborate. I've tried this personally. Brands have egos, and you know, processes and companies. So large, two large brands, very difficult to collaborate. One large brand and one small brand, easier to partner. Very easy to partner with startups because the founders can take decisions like this. I mean, there's a beauty about the way the startups is. But absolutely, I think this is a time for a lot of brand partnerships to happen.
Thank you, Rahul. There are more questions coming. I'll take them. Says somebody called Swamedeep Ghosh. As an outdoor media agency employee, I'm really tense about the future prospects of out of home. If big brands are cutting down marketing budgets, how will out of media, home media survive? There is Ravi Kumar. With increase in online education, what is the plan for urban and rural markets, both in branding and pricing?
See, out of home, I mean, I don't have an answer. But I think, as I said, there'll be, my feeling is that people will start coming out. Bangalore, by the way, I've not stepped out because I'm usually in calls. But many of my friends are going out. They're saying it's like normal. Other than the IT corridor, everyone is out. So I feel that human beings will end up being human beings. And they will do what they've been doing for centuries. They will not suddenly hole up in their houses. So OOH, in my opinion, will come back. Now, every organization, including marketing, media, will have to brace for a tough next 6 months, without a doubt. And I think the test of an organization is, can you survive these 6 months? Right? And if you can't, I think there was an inherent problem in your, as Anurag said, business model. What is the second question, Anurag? Can you tell me again?
You know, in terms of
education,
urban markets, pricing.
Yeah. See, as I said, pricing, I don't think we are looking at pricing at all. You know, we anyway run a tight ship on margins. So I don't think we can reduce the prices, and we definitely will not increase the prices. So I think it's more about messaging and reaching out to customers in a effective and a endearing way. If you appear opportunistic, then I think you will do long-term damage to your brand. So it's a very careful job for marketers right now, for companies like Lenovo, because there is an opportunity for us for sure. We don't know how big, but we have to come across as people who are genuinely trying to help.
So, Rohail Amin, who's a senior editorial colleague, what is your advice to brand managers and brands in these times? Specific advice, one or two.
I'm a little wary, to be honest. I'm a little wary about giving general advice. I think it's not just to brand managers, but to everyone. As I said, that I think this whole situation has given us a lot more thinking time. Therefore, first you should calm your mind down, and this is a great time to do two things. First is really think, push yourself to come up with some ideas and implement them. And second is to think long term. And for brand managers, I would say that you watch your companies. You will know whether your brand has a character or not. Now, everyone will want to claim, but the way you're reacting, organizations as well as the brand, it'll come out whether the value system is authentic or not. And it's a good test. You can write down what is my value, what is the behavior my brand should be demonstrating, and then honestly ask yourself, am I demonstrating that behavior?
Will e-commerce become preferred mode of sales for most brands?
E-commerce will...
Will physical retail become lesser and less important, and will e-retailing become bigger and bigger?
No, I would not take it to that extent. But today, for example, if I look at a consumer laptop market, one out of three laptops are sold online by either Flipkart or Amazon. So that 33% may go up to 40. I don't think it's going to change. In the next 2 months, I think it may be even more 50%. But as I keep saying, everyone, people will want to come back to their whole habit of wanting to see a laptop, compare five laptops, spend 6 hours doing comparisons. So I think the balance right now will tilt. So this whole thing will favor these brands, but it's not going to kill the offline retail totally.
Another question from Ravi Kumar. Going forward, how do you see brand approach impact properties like sports or KBCs or movies? I think the person is from television, so.
Yeah, see, as I said, I think you have to break all these questions into two parts. How is it going to impact in the next 6 months? And then how is it going to impact long term? And there could be W's. We could have more lockdowns. And because nobody knows the trajectory that this disease will take. In the short term, I think everything will get affected. I'm personally, sometimes I feel that once a brand is established, you don't need to spend money on just flashing the logo. So Lenovo was the first company, by the way, to sponsor KBC when I was handling marketing 15 years ago. And we spent a lot of money because Lenovo was unknown. Today, we will never do it. So I think it's all about your context. If you're a new brand, you will continue to do that. If you are an established brand, I think some of those film placement may actually get deprioritized because people will say, I want to spend money on what will give me immediate measurable business.
Fantastic. Thank you for being so real and specific. You know, in terms of being just the content and being real, it's one of the best conversations I've had. So thank you, Rahul. And, you know, because sometimes, as I said, it's leaders are shy to say. I won't say they're being dishonest, but they just, one, they want to keep the optimistic message going. And, you know, so I'd like to ask last two questions and then maybe bring one or two audience questions. One is, what is Rahul Agarwal's personal leadership mantra?
Sorry, personal leadership?
Mantra. You know, what is your leadership style? Oh.
So, I keep three pillars for me. Which one is strategic pillar, second is execution pillar, third is people pillar. And I think a good leader is somebody who has to keep an eye on all three. A leader who's excellent in all three is maybe one in a billion, million. But as a leader, if you can be strong on two, then you are a good leader. But if you're weak on even one pillar, then you will not survive. You will not survive. You can't say that I'm such a brilliant guy and I execute so well, but I'm going to ignore the people element. So first is, I think this tripod balance is very important. I think second is leaders, and I have learned it over the years, Anurag, that the tendency to add value is too much. So the lesser you speak, the more value you add, actually. It has been a very tough learning for me.
Beautiful. The lesser you seek, the more value you add. So you let, basically, Rahul is saying, if I can, you delegate more. You let people take chances, make mistakes, learn, become leaders themselves. You give them an opportunity to fail and learn and hopefully become better leaders.
Yeah, that's right. And the third thing that I've learned lately, I'm still doing it, is that I think ideas will not drop like an apple. You have to push your system and your processes to come up with new ideas and allow people to actually take the risk and fail. I think that only a leader can do. That doesn't happen unless you're a Google kind of an organization with the DNA itself is innovation. I can go on and on, but yeah, these are some of the things that I maybe subconsciously or consciously try.
So Rahul, are you, you know, is there a book you want to recommend to people or a blog or a movie that could help them get through these times?
Yeah, I think a couple of books. The Art of Thinking Clearly is a good book.
By Mr. Dobelli.
Yeah. And he's also written a book of The Art of Living Happy or something like that. So that, I think, maybe is more important in these times.
And Rahul, if you had to say, make one prediction for the future, what would that be? Future means 6 to 12 months. I'm not thinking beyond that.
You know, you're putting me in an uncomfortable zone because it is so easy to predict the future and yet so dangerous. So my feeling is that 90% of the world will come back to normalcy in the next 6 to 12 months.
That's a very optimistic note. And, you know, looking at your answers, which were very real, I hope and pray what you say is real. And I'll take the last audience question. And will brands look for innovative localized media given these difficult circumstances? Rajesh Radhakrishnan from Vritti Media.
Localized, innovative media. Do you mean the content or what?
I mean, he has not specified, but I think that's a fair point to assume. So
the content, I think, see, that debate is always on, right? Always open, global content or local content, and a MNC like Lenovo always deals with it. So I'm a fan of a good hybrid model. I think your global brand ethos need to be preserved. But you will connect more to the audience if you have a local message, which is rooted in a local insight. That is always desirable, COVID or no COVID.
Rahul, though I said last question, what are the positives for you as an individual of this COVID? You know, every cloud has a silver lining. For example, positive for me is that I've lost 2 kg weight. I'm not traveling. I'm eating at home. I'm mostly sleeping well. So I've done no socializing, so no drinking. My health is improved. My focus is improved. What are your personal gains?
See, I thought I was all the MBTI tests have always told me in Iraq that I'm an extreme extrovert, right? It almost suggested that I will go mad if I have to sit alone. I usually sit alone for most of the day. I've been absolutely fine. It's a self-discovery that I'm actually happier, calmer when I'm alone. Number two, I realized I'm speaking 30% less. Everyone is happy about it. My team is happy. I'm doing less calls. So I think there is no end to you being more efficient. I'm sleeping more. I'm sleeping now at least 7 hours, 7 to 7.5. I'm working out more, at least 15 more minutes I've got added. And yes, we are all eating healthy. So I think personally, yeah, I've also lost 2 kilos. I never came, but I've lost because life is healthy. So I think these are some of the benefits I would say that have come to me.
Thank you. Again, thank you for being real, Rahul. I really enjoyed our conversation. And hopefully in the next 30, 60 days, we can, or even earlier, we can get on to another conversation when some of the things you said have actually become a reality. We wish you luck. We wish Lenovo luck. We wish our industry luck. And we look forward to engaging with you on another issue in happier, better times. Over to Khyati.
Thank you,
Anurag. No, I just want to tell you that I think your questions were very real. So that helped me answer them really. They were not hypothetical questions. So thank you for keeping me honest there. And it was a pleasure coming here. And I wish Exchange for Media all the best. I think the way you guys are dealing with this situation is quite admirable. And I think I wish you all the success for this e-conclave.
Thank you, Rahul. You've been a big support to us and part of our big initiatives over the last 7, 8 years, 10 years. And we hope to continue to engage with you on this. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rahul.
Thank you. So thank you, Mr. Agarwal and Dr. Batra, for such an insightful session. And we thank, of course, Mr. Agarwal for giving us his valuable time.